You're back with Q&A and we're here with Education Minister Chris Hipkins. I want to talk about the issue of school principals and their term. One of the suggestions is having a five-year cycle. Do the job, then you move on. I want to address one of the questions that one of the parents put to you. It says, Mr. Hipkins, we have an absolutely phenomenal principal at our local school. Our community would be devastated if she moved on after five years. What assurances can you give to her?
I don't think that's actually what the task force intended the report to suggest, and it's certainly not something that I would buy into.
So that's out?
Well, I think the task force themselves have already said that that's out. I think they've already had a lot of feedback on that, and I think that they're finding it a bit of a distraction from some of the other debates they'd rather be
But having. Isn't the point that it is a challenge to get rid of teachers who aren't performing, and isn't that part of the reason that that came up as a suggestion?
No, I don't accept that actually. And the principals who I've spoken to who have had challenges with teachers who haven't been performing have said that there is a process there, that they can manage those. But actually, there's also a process there to ensure that those teachers have the opportunity to improve so that they can be better teachers. In some cases, they go on to become very, very good teachers.
Okay, so that's off the table. That will be a relief to many out there who have concerns. Zoning. Do you think that all kids should go to their local school?
Look, I would prefer that kids went to their local school. Actually, the New Zealand Initiative were out there this morning saying that decile is no indicator of success. There is this perception that if you go across town to a higher decile school, you'll get a better quality education. That's simply not borne out
but
by.
But there are good schools and bad schools.
That's simply not borne out by the evidence. Actually, that New Zealand schools do perform very well when you allow for background factors and other things outside the school gate.
So all schools perform well?
By and large, and we do pick up the ones that don't through regular education review office reports and so on. Now, I'm not saying that every school is perfect. We wouldn't be doing this exercise if I thought that every school was perfect.
Doesn't it take away parents' choice, though? You might want your child to go to a single-sex school. You might want a more strict environment. You might want something that focuses on drama, on sport. Shouldn't parents be allowed to choose?
Well, parents do have that choice now, and I wouldn't be suggesting that choice is taken away. I don't think we'll ever go back to the hard zoning that we would have had prior to 1989, where you basically had one choice of school and that was that. Parents do have a choice now of all of the sorts of things that you've mentioned.
But there could be changes?
Well, actually, in some areas, those changes are already happening. So if you look here in Auckland, for example, there are many fewer out-of-zone places available in Auckland schools out of necessity, because the inner city is growing, more people are living there, and there is less space. In Christchurch, after the earthquakes, with the school rebuilds, there are far fewer out-of-zone places available at many of those
schools.
But
when you break this all down, as a Labor Minister of Education, you want kids going to their local school.
My message to parents is that we believe that their local school should be and can be and will be providing the very best quality of education to their child. That's what we're aiming to achieve. Now, I think that New Zealand schools, by and large, are there. That is what they are offering. I think some of the statistics can be misleading. But where there are issues, we want to identify them and address them.
I want to go through a couple of things quickly. Donations. Should schools be allowed to ask for donations to top up where there's funding gaps?
Well, I don't think schools should have to. At the moment, there's no question.
Should they be able to, though?
Well, at the moment, there's no question that in many cases schools have to ask for donations because the funding is insufficient, and the government's made some commitments about how we will address those. Those are subject to budget discussions, of course.
Because they haven't come through yet, have they?
They're subject to budget discussions, and so I can't get into that here for the reasons that we haven't done the
budget
yet.
So we shouldn't rule it out completely. It's coming, is your message.
Look, we've been very clear. In this term of Parliament, we've made some commitments around giving schools extra funding so they don't have to rely on donations, and we will absolutely deliver on that.
Because just to be clear for people watching who perhaps don't know the background, you have promised that schools won't have to ask for donations, that if they say no, you don't have to give donations, you will top that up for them. You haven't come through on that yet, though.
No, and we might not come through on that all in one go, but we have made an absolute commitment that, we want to ensure that schools are properly funded so they're not reliant on donations.
So we should watch very closely in this budget then, I presume. Intermediate schools, get rid of them? very expensive. What do you think?
I think what the task force have suggested there is if you were designing a school system from scratch, it might not be the primary, intermediate, secondary model that is most dominant in New Zealand. But the reality is, I think, reconfiguring all of the existing schools to fit a different kind of model, whether that's the junior high school model or whatever, would be hugely disrupted, and I'm not disruptive, and I'm not convinced that you get huge gains from that. So where you're allowing for growth, where you're building new schools for growth, there has been a move towards junior high schools and senior high schools and so on, and they seem to be working very, very well. But I don't think that you'll see us massively reconfiguring all of the intermediate schools in the country suddenly overnight.
Let's have a look at the politics around this. Why the rush? 3.5 weeks, as we heard there, one of the parents saying, ridiculous.
Well, I'm not sure where 3.5 weeks has
come from. The consultation period.
The consultation period started before Christmas.
But there were school holidays. And is
still ongoing now.
I think
they finished in the weekend. So that's four and a bit months that they've been consulting for. So 3.5 weeks, I'm not sure where that comes from.
But come on, you can't say over the school holidays when parents and teachers and students aren't there.
Well, I mean, I don't think you can discount, 7 weeks of the year completely. Actually, that is often a time when people reflect on how the school system is operating.
But what's the rush?
Look, there isn't a particular rush. We've been very clear this is quite an iterative process. The task force started its work last year, beginning of last year. They had a whole year of conversations. They produced some recommendations. We put them out. We've asked people to give, or the task force have asked people to give feedback.
Have they had enough time, the task force?
The task force have asked for more time to digest the submissions.
Right, how long?
And we have given them some extra time to do that. And then when they come back to us, obviously we'll consider what's being proposed. And then there may well be more consultation required.
So that's new. So how long will they have to come back to you?
They've asked for another couple of months to actually consider the submissions, and I've certainly indicated that that's not a problem.
Just finally, National, you really need cross-party support on this. Otherwise, when they get into power next, they bring back the changes that you've made. Where are you at with that?
I think that the National Opposition and Nikki Kaye, the National Party spokesperson in particular, have been very constructive in this process. Nikki Kaye is a former Minister of Education and has grappled with many of the issues that I'm grappling with now. And so where we can reach consensus, I think that's far preferable. My message, of course, to everybody in education is if you're striving for consensus, that means you don't get everything that you want, but if you're willing to compromise, then you might get something that's more enduring. And, if we can reach that point where we can get some compromise and something that's much more enduring, then we're definitely open for that conversation.
Well, look, that's a nice place to leave it. Thank you very much for your time this evening, the Education Minister, Chris Hipkins.